Okay, good. Enough of that.
Yep.
Yeah, okay, good. Open the meeting, it's about 7:40, and have to advise everybody that this is being televised and recorded. Minutes, Judy, didn't get the, no, okay. All right. Local variance. Oh, by the way, Jim Malley just texted me if we need his input on anything tonight. He's available by the phone. He just texted me a few minutes ago. 13 Ramsford Road, Heritage Design. How are you?
I got a pretty boring job after seeing you come in.
What about that now?
Lance Anderson from Heritage Design Group.
Okay.
That's my mail name. I've got a septic system at 13 Ramsford. Okay, if I put it up on the desk?
Oh, absolutely, yes. Please do.
Asking for local variance for the septic tank offset to the property line to 5 feet.
Yes, okay. This is it, okay.
And asking for a variance for the separation from septic tank to cellar wall.
Okay.
And we did a, when I tested it with Jim, the groundwater was too high to do a percolation rate, so we sent it to a lab and did a sieve analysis.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, okay.
And that's...
And the sieve analysis was...
That's about it. That okay. was yeah done by JBN in okay. Worcester. So there's an existing home here.
And this,
so Jim still has to basically approve this, so as long as we're okay with it, it's pending Jim's...
Pending Jim's approval.
Correct.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Correct.
So on your offsets, the only thing I'd recommend is the mono tanks. Can they get in here off the road? Is there access to this?
Yes.
Yeah, right off the road?
Yeah. Ramshorn's a right-of-way that splits all the properties.
So maybe doing a mono tanks on there. Seeing you looking for your offset to your foundation.
Okay.
Yeah, monolithic tank.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
It's not a problem, but right. It's not even a problem. It's the only thing I really see.
Yeah, okay. See anything? Like, there's nothing alarming to you about this?
No. Nope.
Okay. Good. Yeah, I don't have any.
Yeah,
you good?
Yeah,
Jim's going to look at it. Good.
No.
Yeah. All right. Good. So, unless they make a motion for.
I'll make a motion to accept the variance request upon Jim Malley's approval and review of the setback from 10 feet required to 5 foot from the pump chamber and septic tank property line, and 6 feet from 10 feet from pump chamber and septic tank to foundation wall, and to allow the sieve analysis on the groundwater or percolation test.
Very good. All in favor?
Do you have some other special requirement that you would say? No,
yeah, that's true. I'm sorry. The only thing I suggest is we change the pump chamber in the septic tank to a monolithic one piece on these approvals.
Okay, great. All in favor?
Second.
Okay, second. Okay, all in favor?
All right,
very good. Okay, you're all set.
Thank you, folks.
Okay, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yep.
No problem. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Judy.
Thank you.
Okay, 13 Sunrise Bedroom Count.
5 Sunrise, he's not coming tonight.
Okay.
It was someone I had spoken to previously. He was going to submit house plans, and I told him I would pencil him in. I hadn't heard from him, so I left him on the agenda.
Okay.
He's on his honeymoon, so he actually called me. So, however, you want to take a look at it just to see. This is... he installed the septic and then now is tearing down the house. So the septic was installed based on the existing house.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
The existing bedrooms.
So
what is he looking to do?
So now he's going to tear down the house. But the septic's already in now.
It was only designed for a 2-bedroom.
They couldn't get a
3-bedroom. It's only a 1-bedroom house, though.
But they must not. But you gotta go 3, right? If you can get 3 in.
Well, it's a deed restriction. Yeah, you couldn't get 3 in.
How
long ago was this? Just
2018.
So he eventually is going to come before the board and.
Oh, this is 13.
Was this the plan all along, or why?
I don't know. It didn't seem to be at the time, so I
And he hasn't, he didn't, this was his, he change, didn't change ownership, right? He's had this property the whole.
So what's he looking at doing, I'm
yeah.
sorry?
So now he's tearing down the house.
Yeah, what's he coming to the board for? What's he looking for?
He wants more than one bedroom house. And it's
well, it's designed for two, they could have designed it for one, with a one bedroom restriction, right?
See, it's designed for two, because that's the minimum, isn't it?
Well,
I've seen one bedroom designs, believe it or not. I don't know if it's code, but.
I think they're designed less than two, but anyway. If you look at the field card, though.
Well, how big is the lot and stuff? I mean, I'm confused. Let's see.
I don't have house plans yet, though, so eventually it will have to come before you.
What's the size of the lot? Just saying that, Kenny.
It might be on the other side of the building. The bottom.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's going to be treated as new. This gets into this whole new construction.
He's up in the bedrooms. It's going to be new construction, right?
You can't increase a non-conforming existing use. You can't increase flow to, right?
Right. If it was only a one bedroom, is it listed?
You have to design it. You always got to put in a three if you can get a three. But you can't increase flow to and non-conforming existing use, right?
Right.
So if you got a one bedroom, you're going to have a three bedroom. You always got to put in a three if you can get it in, but you're still not going to be able to increase flow to it because it's a.
I know.
Right? You're not supposed to, you know. Well, we always give, historically, we can call Jim about this if anybody has any questions. Jim allows one room on the main living floor that could be counted by Title V as a bedroom. With ceiling height and square footage and heat and the window and all this kind of stuff. But he allows it because people usually have a den or a study or something. You know, he allows, we've always allowed that as our bedroom count to allow one room on the main floor. It needs to be on the main floor, not upstairs. So, I mean, I guess.
He's doing
is this the type of thing that you need to go to do a walkthrough and see
like
what the existing floor plan is before he tears it down?
I would like to see it. Well, we probably have that on the field card, actually.
Is that one big
it
bedroom?
Looks like a one bedroom and I think it says it's a one bedroom on the field
it
card.
It does say it's one bedroom.
Sleeping porch is highly unlikely. It would be something we probably would want to see. I mean the overall thing on this, right, is if he wants to tear the house down and build a similar size house with similar number of bedrooms, we've always embraced that. But if we've been through this before.
Yeah, he's going by what it was designed for, so he's trying to up it to the two.
Yeah.
Because it was designed, it's capable of handling a two.
Right. And if it's a non-conforming existing use.
I don't think a deed restriction was put on this house because there was no house being constructed at this time.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. As soon as you approve a plan for two bedrooms, it's required a deed restriction be put on it.
Oh.
But we should see what the deed restriction says.
Oh.
If it's restricted to two bedrooms, then it might be an issue.
Right, right.
Hmm.
I guess we could look into the deed restriction and take a look at the house. That makes sense. And have him, I would, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I'd look at the deed restriction and then we could take it from there and then see, you know, if he's building a two-bedroom and it's got an office or den.
And
an
art room and all
that
other stuff, yeah.
Three-bedroom.
Right, right. We're lenient as possible on these things, but, you know, we've been down this road before and we definitely want to see very specific house plans, nothing hand drawn.
Yeah.
You know, we've been through
that's
that
why
before.
He was on the agenda too.
Right.
But he didn't have it ready yet.
Mm-hmm.
I had talked to him like a month ago, so
I
said, "Well, I'll pencil you in if you're ready, you can come."
Yeah, it would be appropriate for us to tell him we need to details on the deed restriction, and we would like to view the house before it's torn down, which may work in his favor, because there might be a room there that he's, that, you know, usually these bedroom counts work in the homeowner's favor, believe it or not.
Right.
They really do, you know.
Yeah.
So, it certainly doesn't, I don't think it's ever gotten worse. If anything, they get an extra room. What do you think, Dan?
I almost feel like, I swear we saw this. Or maybe it was one just like, I remember having this whole conversation about a
sleeping
porch.
That was Lynn's.
That might have been Lynn's.
Okay.
Yeah. The sleeping porch is, yeah, the...
That has come up before.
That has a sleeping porch has come up before.
That's why. They all blend after a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I swear we had
that.
Yeah,
we have had this before. Yeah, it was Lynn's.
Yeah, almost every cabin down there has got a two bedrooms with a sleeping porch and sleeps 15 people.
Exactly. That's right. Exactly. Yeah, 15 people are there for 3 months and the septic is going bad. It sleeps 15. That's the truth, though. Okay. Let's see. Review Jim Manley local upgrade approvals. 170 Armsby Road, distance to own well.
I left you the file there if you wanted to look at it. Although Jim is still reviewing that one, I think it's up here.
Or is it up here? Okay.
In the file.
Is this it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's one that Jim will just approve.
Yeah. This is just what is it? It's distance to own well. What's the reduction? Let's see what the reduction is. Jim just does these things. It's fine. Whatever Jim wants to do with it is good. Recognition rate. I don't see it here, but yeah, obviously, you know what the form looks like there. Than I know people can use it.
Fifty-nine
feet from, that's for 100, right?
Yep.
No. Okay, yeah, that's reasonable. Because anything under 50, I think, has to the EPS get involved, right?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, that'll be a no-brainer for Jim.
130 off the other.
Department update.
I have some information from Cheryl.
Okay.
She attended a forum on homelessness. Said it was very informative. That was in Northbridge. She's also in March going to be attending a DEP winter update at Fort Devens. And she's going to a cannabis update in later March. She also went to a symposium that Jen Hager held on recreational marijuana.
Okay.
Which she said was very informative. She said the Board of Health will be involved if any edibles are allowed in town, becomes a food product. So, and she's also hired a new nurse coming on board to help assist her with a variety of nursing functions.
Oh, good for her. Well, that's good. Huge, that's huge.
So that was on Cheryl's end. And then I left you a letter from DEP that we received in regards to ETR Labs. And the letter from DEP specifically stated that they were revoking ETR Labs' Mass DEP certification. Immediately,
really?
Is what the letter says. It's a 4-page letter.
Mm-hmm.
It gets into detail as to why. I then, as a courtesy, sent out an email to our well drillers and a couple of contractors that, you know, send out water testing to let them know, because we can only accept results from a DEP certified lab.
Mm-hmm.
So ETR called me this morning, and I spoke for almost an hour to a gentleman at ETR Labs, Nick LeMay, explaining that, he explained the processes that they use at ETR Labs. He's appealing this letter and has been added back onto DEP's list as a certified lab. Feels that notice that was sent to all boards of health from DEP was premature.
That's a letter.
Okay, that's a letter.
Yeah, there's also a letter from DTR, his attorney.
Okay, oh, really?
Going on immediately saying that they, that should be revoked.
Alright.
So they told Judy when she called that they are currently on the list.
They are back on the list.
They're back on the list, yes.
But they never sent a rebuttal email to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, jeez, okay, so DEP never.
So that's a little scary.
So this is a,
That's not right, yeah.
We got a thing from Westminster, I told them, we got one from Westminster stating that we can no longer use them, sending us that.
Really? That's not good.
So, I mean, I want your input, of course, but I mean,
No,
as per our regulations, they have to be a state certified lab. Currently, they are a state certified lab. And I feel we should allow.
Yeah, I think so too.
I think so too, I mean, if DEP in this appeal, if DEP feels like during this appeal process that, you know, if it, there are enough safeguards in place, then that's good enough for us, right?
Yep.
We should renew that, right?
I called DEP today as well.
Yeah, and they are back on the approved list.
They are on the list, yes, and
I mean, I don't.
It's, I think, gonna be a legal battle between DEP and this company, so.
Well, until.
I don't wanna be in.
No, it's not our pla- I mean, our bottom line is that if you're done DEP list, you're good, and if they're on there, back on there, then we're good.
Right, they were not recommending that, but they don't wanna take them off their list, so why do we take them off our list?
They, he got in, Nick LeMay at UTR got into very technical information of their processes, the equipment they use. He stated their equipment is more advanced than what DEP uses, and he feels very confident that they will win their appeal, so.
Okay, well,
They're on the list.
They're on the list, well, until we get notification that their, this appeal process worked, you know, against them or whatever, it didn't work in their favor, then we're good.
Yep.
Okay, where are they, where's this, it's in
Leominster.
Oh, Leominster? Oh, no, that's the DE,
Do you have any that are outstanding right now that you know have gone to specifically to use them?
Probably.
I think that Westford.
Probably.
It just gives their identification number, it doesn't say.
A lab that you deal with quite a bit, or you see.
Yeah, there's only a couple of labs most people
Oh, Leominster, no, it is Leominster.
They have to be in the area. So a lot of people use them,
Is that their primary business, is just water, just doing?
Yeah.
It's detrimental for their business.
And they do like effluent testing and stuff also, so any kind of water and effluent and stuff.
Okay, well, yeah, we're good, thank you for the update, but yeah, we're, that's fine. I don't know, people saw, I don't know if, I think everybody got a copy of Cheryl's,
Yeah.
Well, that's Cheryl and, the town report is due this week, and so I completed that.
Yeah.
Submitted that to Laura.
Okay, very good. Immunization 690, 166 home visits, that's a lot, every other day.
With the new nurse that she hired, are they working different shifts, or is that, like, are her hours supplementing the hours that Cheryl does?
No.
Or are they overlapping, or are they at the same time?
I believe it's at the same time, I don't know. Cheryl probably has her helping her with, disease follow-ups and things like that.
Gotcha.
I don't know. I just met her today for the first time, so.
Good. Yeah, there's a lot more stuff going on than we realize, you know, it's, you people are busy. There's no question about it. And it's just such a wide ranging stuff from beaver trapping permits and burial permits, and we look at this, it's barn inspections. All right, good.
It just as an added note, I still track Title V reports per your instructions in regards to cesspools.
Okay, right.
But you've never asked me any further follow-up regarding
right,
that.
How many was that? Yeah. All right. I know. I remember that. No, we remember we were talking about that, whether you mentioned that some places don't even allow a cesspool, right? You can upgrade it, period. And then we were talking about
I haven't.
How many? Yeah, I'd be curious to know.
How many failures were cesspools, I think was what your question. The reason of.
How many were there?
I don't know. I haven't figured that out.
Can you tell
yet.
Us? Okay, next time, can you pull it up a little spreadsheet?
I could. I've been waiting for you to ask.
Okay. I would be very curious to know. Yeah. Well, that was, I think the reason we wanted you to tally that was
they get fewer and fewer.
Well, thank you. If you could tell it for the next meeting and actually shoot me an email when you get it.
They get fewer and fewer. The ones that are left. A lot of them have survived Title V, and they're not in the water table, so.
Yeah, we've been letting them go, and then we thought, we kicked around a little bit, like, because an interim thing, like, maybe if there was room for a tank between the house and the cesspool, putting the tank, there's the increased treatment, but, you know, we kicked that around. There was no really good solution, I think, so. But I'd be curious to know how many of them.
I also left you Ray's food inspection.
I saw that, yeah, okay. No critical violations. He's very pleased with some of the people who've had come before us. They made huge improvements, huge improvements. So he's very, really pleased. Nothing critical, okay. So you used to have Steve Rice, the expert, look at all this stuff. He knew what I was looking at. but so he's what I mean I this is too, I should know this what is it a every 6 months he inspects the typical restaurant?
Well, he has to do
twice a year is what it's mandatory, and then
December and June.
Okay, all right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Supplemental Title V. I really don't have anything more with that other than what we talked about at the last meeting. I think I'll be able to get some input from Jim on that over the next few weeks, which would be instrumental. So why don't we just shelve that for now. Guinea hens, I missed one, I guess. TCE, is there nothing to do with that?
Carrier Lane. I spoke to Margaret Bacon. I sent all of you an email regarding that. She is backed up and in the process of doing the design. So it's really in her hands right now. So
okay.
She said she was about a month out.
Okay. Yeah, I said I was going to call him at the last meeting, but after having Judy have this conversation with the engineer, it's like a moot point. All right. So that's most of that's
progress.
Yeah, progress. Yeah, exactly. Guinea hens, nothing new there other than I spoke with Cheryl Sabara, who's mentioned her before. She's the attorney for the Massachusetts Health Officers Association. I spoke to her and asked her. I'm still hoping this problem's going to disappear here with the warm weather. We'll see. If not, she said she would help us draft a letter for us on her letterhead. She'd have to put a disclaimer in there that she's not member of the town council or not a member of the board, but she could help us emphasize the legal aspects of our enforcement over this issue. So if we need that, we've got, I just spoke with her actually today about that. So if we need that, we've got that to help us with that issue. Discuss implementing improved regulations. I mean, I don't know what we can do to. I mean, we still need to come up, I think, with a fine structure, but the whole nuisance thing is just such, it's this broad kind of based thing. I mean, there's noise and there's trash, and it's kind of whatever we. And actually, I might be able to get Cheryl to come in here and speak with us some evening at one of the upcoming meetings about overall jurisdiction for us on these issues and and what other towns have done to come up with some regulations, because I'm kind of flat-footed on the whole thing, really, and it never comes up. We never had a problem with it until it is a problem.
Right.
You know?
No, it sounds like a good idea. I'd be interested to hear what she'd have to say.
I'll see if Cheryl will. I think Cheryl would be willing to come in. I'll get a hold of her. Well, we leave it at that for now, because she's an expert on that stuff.
We have listed here that we have 3 nuisance complaints.
Apparently, over the past year,
we've had.
I don't know, one was.
But they've fixed them.
They fixed them. There was one trash. I forget where I went. Somebody's trash. Their neighbor had excessive amount of trash and kind of dumped it from his driveway over an embankment type of thing. And went over and talked to him, and they got together. And I think they actually helped each other clean it up. It was fine, you know. But we've had stuff like that, yeah. But they've all resolved themselves other than this.
Mm-hmm.
What other nuisances? What were the 3 nuisances? Probably the getting.
I don't recall, because this is 17 to 16, so this was.
This was a while ago.
I just did a count. I didn't read the specific nuisances.
Yeah, okay.
We had the pig thing, didn't we? The pig that was running around. I don't know if
we
that
did
was
have a pig. Yeah,
nuisance.
We did have a pig running around. Yeah, that was down in Manchog, wasn't it? I think that was the pig and the. There was some livestock issues there.
Yeah. Oh, we had the farm. That was the biggest one. Do you remember the makeshift farm?
Yes, I do.
That was probably from there. That was actually several complaints regarding the makeshift farm.
Yeah, that was on a mantra.
The pallets and our animal inspector had to make several visits there. You went too.
Yeah, I went down there. Yeah, a couple. Yeah, the animal inspector. Yeah.
Yeah, that was one.
That was one, and then the roosters, remember the roosters?
There was the rooster.
There were the noisy roosters.
Yes, the noisy roosters.
Yeah, the recording of the roosters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's excitement. I'm done.
Good stuff.
That got resolved.
It did, no. Yeah. Well, they all.
They all did.
They all did, up until, yes. Let's see. Proof fine schedule. I didn't have a chance. I was too lazy to do it, and I forgot. You didn't look at any neighboring towns' fines. You've been so busy. No, you don't have to apologize. I'll make a point of doing that for the next meeting. Maybe get Cheryl to come in here in the next meeting, too. And the wells, there was really nothing new on the wells. I mean, we read through that stuff. They seem excessive in some respects.
It was the testing issues.
I mean, we've simplified it some. We've taken off the SOCs for a good portion of the town. And I don't know what else we can do.
I don't really either.
To make it easier. I mean, did Jim talk to you about that? About the interpreting well results, stuff like that? No, okay. He left me a message. I haven't spoken about it, but he left me a message a few days ago, and I haven't been able. I called him, and he wasn't available. Hopefully, he said he's available tomorrow to speak. But, he thinks he does have concern. I think that we need to be careful about over involvement of us interpreting well results, you know, and that kind of thing. So we need to. Jim has some input on it. I don't know it was a general message about that, and we need. So you might want to call him since you're the person doing it, and I'll call him too. But he thinks that there should be adequate resources out there for the residents via labs and well company. You know, the people that are involved with getting these wells set up to help them with it. I mean, I know you're overly helpful, and we appreciate that, but, you know, it would make your life simpler, too.
One of your concerns for the residents is usually, what is the term you use? Overly burdensome?
Overly burdensome.
I think a engineer or an environmental company would be costly for the resident, so adding that in.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I think extremely costly. I don't know, but
you're right, and we don't want to do that.
If that is the route you go with, I think it would make more sense to reduce your testing.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
If you're going to have to pay an outside person to analyze it anyway, then just reduce the testing.
Yeah, I mean,
can't they ask their laboratory to read it for them? I mean, I've called the lab several times to go over the results, and something that doesn't make sense to me, they explain it to me over the phone.
Yeah.
You can call them and talk to them right on the phone and say, I got this results, the town's requiring this. Does it pass or not? And they're like, no, you have this, 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 and this. They're requiring this.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I feel like saying, why don't you write that on the paper? But
yeah, but they don't.
But they don't.
Will they?
But they,
I mean,
but they will explain it to you.
They will. I've talked to them several times.
Mm-hmm.
I mean.
But like you said, you have to review it and you have to catch it, is what you're saying, because they're turning it in.
Well, but she was doing the conversions too,
they have to
weren't
do
you?
The conversions.
Right.
They have to do the.
And you were checking it basically instead of getting a report that said pass, fail.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, ultimately, I don't even know if it's realistic. Would be, you know, have them pick up the requirements, pick up, sign a home for the homeowner, as long as they're going to get them with the homeowner more in the loop on what it's going to take, and then they go out and do all the thing, and they come to you with this perfect report that says everything's in compliance. Like, that
would be nice, right?
Yeah. I don't see it happening.
You don't see it happening?
I
know
really
you
don't. You know why? Because there's dual steps. Someone has to tell this person, first we need to see the results prior to filtration. That's what we require, okay? As per the regulations, we require seeing the results prior to filtration. Then, so someone has to then tell them what needs to be filtered. That's the piece. They don't know what needs to be filtered. They don't know then the results are not okay when they're handing them to me. They don't know we're not saying, oh, these are fine, until I tell them, no, you have to filter this, filter this, filter this. Then they go to a filter company, have the filter company filter those contaminants and retest those contaminants. Then I get new reports for those contaminants
right.
that were filtered.
But
who's?
Yeah, I mean, I can.
They don't know it's not okay. I guess is the that piece, you know.
So they can't.
They're looking for me to sign off. Is this okay? I want to have occupancy in my house.
So
building inspector is saying, are you all set with that? Can they have occupancy? And I say, no, their water is not okay.
So is it the missing link that, does it say in our regs, this, if this, this, and this is too high, you need to go filter that?
Yeah, well, it does, but it's not straightforward. It's always, some of them are, but on like, if gross alpha is greater than 5 picocuries but equal to or less than 15, then test for radium 226 and radium 228. Even that piece, they don't know to do until I explain it to them. They give me the results and I say, your gross alpha is over 5. I don't see radium 226 and radium 228 on this report. Do you know, sometimes those tests take longer. I go, do you know if they're running those? And they just don't know.
A lab doesn't get involved with any of this stuff?
The lab gives them the reports based on our regulations. And then
okay,
they
when
the reports to
call,
me.
When you get to talk, call Jim tomorrow and ask Jim what he thinks. Jim may have some ideas because he deals with this in other towns. I'm sure he may have a way to streamline this. I mean, certainly we have to be as helpful to the resident as we can, but it seems overly burdensome for you.
It's just a process. There's a lot of players involved with wells. I was talking to a well driller tonight about it. I asked him his opinion, actually, because he's and he said, yeah, it's a process. It just is a process.
Right.
There should almost be
a review fee.
He was saying that
you gotta pay somebody to do it. Is
he
what
said,
it comes down to.
He wouldn't say what town, but he said one town. It was $500 for the permit, and he said, which he thought was outrageous. And it took 6 weeks for the engineer at the Board of Health to review the results of the water.
Yeah,
6 weeks.
Because some towns are just taking it and not even reviewing it. So if you're gonna take the time to review it, then you should be getting paid to do that.
Well, if they take it.
Or you should be able to pay somebody to do that.
How are they issuing occupancy, by just taking it? Are they just, what's the point of having the test if they don't know if it's okay or not?
It's like a Title V test, it's required, right?
It's required, but it has to pass or fail.
Who says that anybody has to do anything with it? A lot of towns stick it in a file.
Yeah, that's what I do.
Don't review it, don't nothing, you know what I mean? There could be all kinds of stuff on there. I've turned in further evaluation from Board of Health before and it's stuck in a file.
Mm-hmm.
Customer calls me and says, what's going on? I just call you Board of Health. They have no idea it was in a file. So,
mm-hmm.
And then other towns
well,
got fees and they're reviewing them, you know, and they bounce them back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, you didn't fill this out, you didn't do that. They're almost doing, I know it's a little bit different, I understand what you're saying, but they're doing what you're doing. They're taking the time to review them,
yeah.
Pick them apart, and tell these people that they're wrong or not done right, whether it be the inspector or the homeowner has something that they need to do. So you're almost doing that with the water test results, so maybe the fees need to go up for that.
I don't know, yeah.
So they can pay your time or somebody else's time to review them.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. But does it get pushed back onto Judy or does it get pushed onto Jim? Like, what's the level?
It really is Jim, but I help Jim.
Right.
You know?
So it could be an assistant to either one of them.
So when Jim comes in, you know,
how many wells did
you do? I highlight things for Jim. And so with the water results, that's what I, it is Jim, but I go
so
through
it's well
it for him
facilitator
and
for him and that kind of thing.
Bring right. The key things to his attention.
So that would fall under well permits?
Well, yeah, we need to get some input from Jim, because Jim did, the other thing about voicemail lady was, you know, this was a concern. For him, you know, and I call him back and I just haven't been able to get back in touch with him. We're going to talk tomorrow morning, so I'll have a little more information. Or I could call him right now and ask him if you want. He said he was available. No,
it's all right.
Okay, we can call him right. He did say he was available. Streamlining the process and getting the monkey off your back is important because she spends an inordinate amount of time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. We need to resolve this.
What the hell are you doing over there?
But that was good. I like that. Again, it would probably fall the right thing to do. It would fall under an RS or a PE or something like that. Whether it be they pay us to, I mean, it has to be reviewed. Obviously, for you to sign off on it. So if we're signing, if
that's
the town's signing
it.
Off on it,
the
it really shouldn't be you reviewing it, signing it off on it. You know what I mean? I don't think you want that responsibility.
Well, it is. It's really Jim.
Right.
And I assist Jim.
And the
right.
Fee might have to go up for Jim to do that.
Yeah. I mean, for Jim. Yeah, Jim. I think you know he does a lot of pro bono stuff for us. Yeah. Very generous of him, but if he spends, this has gotten more complicated.
Well, it is.
Yeah.
And how many of these a year come through that, like just roughly, that you're doing this whole review
what's
on?
What's it say on the annual report?
16. For a new, it's well permits, right?
Well permits,
yeah.
Yeah,
16.
16.
So
and
how basically
long do you
double
think
that, because you're doing two tests per one, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you got 32. And then you got ones that come back, so those probably linger.
It's a process, because
yeah.
There's multiple people involved.
How long do you think you spend on the average? For the time people pull in
total,
a call report, total.
From the two.
You know, time you spend.
Not the ones that took forever, and not the ones that were
the
like
average.
Wicked smart. What do you think an average is?
An average? Like a week? Or an average a week?
Per one.
Oh, an average for one. How much time do I spend?
Okay.
It can be an hour for one, because of the calls.
Yeah, right.
I mean,
yeah.
Sometimes I have to consult with DEP. there's that factor sometimes. Sometimes I have to call the lab.
Then the owner, then the well driver.
I mean.
Yeah, it's a messy.
It can be messy, and the person before me typically doesn't really understand it. They're like, sometimes it can, when the person doesn't understand it, the resident doesn't understand it, it's easier for me just to make the calls with them sitting there. So I will call his lab for him. I will call his filtration company for him while he's sitting there. I mean, we have to be friendly to the residents, and we can't just say, here, figure it out. I mean.
No, we really, I don't know if we can be that harsh. No, we need to be helpful. No, we've always been.
Yeah, that's how it falls under professionals getting their hands on stuff like this, because the homeowners don't know. That's why there's engineers that design septic systems. That's why there's lawyers, and that's why there's this, that, and the other thing, because they don't understand. You know, that's not, that we don't expect them to understand that.
Yeah.
You know.
So once I review the results, I would call the homeowner, or I would email if it was a contractor, and I would tell them the findings. This is out of range. This is, you know, exceeds the maximum contaminant level. I would explain what needed to be filtered, and then they need to retest, and then I get the retest, hopefully.
Yeah, it's cool.
So you gotta talk to Jim.
I'll talk to Jim. But he's concerned too, and would like to somehow streamline this, but. Yeah, we certainly need to be helpful, but you know, it's an inordinate amount of your time. If we could get some of the monkey off your back.
Yeah, if you didn't have to do the overall review and you were just trying to help a scattered customer occasionally here and there, it would be perfect, you know.
Right. It needs to be the exception, not the rule, that you do this.
It seems to be the rule.
Yeah,
that's
what we need to do. They're occasionally going
to
have a homeowner that, you know, whatever reads, hold their hand a little more, that's one thing. But when it's with every well that we drill.
It just seems to never really go smooth.
Right.
And I had a resident who I explained to him what needed to be done. He didn't, you know, it's involved. So he just took his results to the filtration company, someone he was used to dealing with, and he said, here, fix this. But he didn't tell them what I said, and they filtered and retested the wrong thing. Now, what I told him, just try retesting, because they were radionuclide, so maybe the filter might have been the same for both contaminants. So I said, just retest for the one I need, and so then he had a retest for the one I needed. And it was okay. It was okay. But I had to call the filtration company because he had just paid for this very expensive filter, which could have been wrong.
Mm.
And he hands me the report. I go, that's not what I asked for. I asked for
Yeah, that's the kind of thing we need to get you. You shouldn't have to be.
It's great.
Don't get me wrong. I mean, I'm very appreciative of how helpful you are, as always, but it's just too much.
They just never seem to go very smooth. Like I said, the radium 226 and radium 228, numerous times when the gross alpha is over 15, I don't have the radium 226 and radium 228. I'm like, is the lab testing for that still? And they don't know. So I call.
We need to come up with that more knowledge before. I mean, people are, you know, the average homeowner's got to be smart enough to read this. You know, they just think everything's going to get done for them. Well, you know, this is not the, you know, the health department in Boston or whatever that has all these resources, probably, where, you know, this stuff is automated. And I'm sure that's, you know, being in big communities, this stuff is probably really automated. They feed the results in, it spits out a report, it mails it to the homeowner or whoever the property owner is, and said, this is out, fix it, make it so, and come back.
I had one resident who was absolutely furious with me over this and accused me of having them test erroneously for things they didn't need to test for because of the gross alpha and the radium 226 and radium 228.
Really?
Because that test is lengthy. I believe it can take like 6 weeks. He was absolutely furious with me.
Well, don't. You shouldn't have to put up with that.
You know, out of my control.
Yeah,
I mean, maybe there's a way that we could take the most common questions and like create a hard card or something that you could more easily give to them. Because in these examples, you're helping them, you're telling them what they need, and they're still doing it wrong.
I know, but it's not just necessarily them, it's then the filtration company or the lab didn't pull enough sample. That's another thing that happens sometimes. I go through the results, I go, you didn't test for gross alpha. They forgot to pull enough sample to test for gross alpha. And then they had to go back. Then I had a case where...
So they're just giving you the results, knowing that they didn't test what they needed to test.
But they don't realize it when they hand it to me. It's the resident handing me this. It's like looking at, you know, they're lengthy tests. It's like looking at blood work, and they didn't realize that's missing.
There's homeowner
but the professionals that they're hiring should.
Let's have a checklist.
Don't come to the Board of Health and don't submit this until these things are, you know.
But this is the
but it needs to be
you
a.
Know,
I don't know if we can.
I don't know how to simplify it. It
right,
is
right,
this
right,
simple.
No, it's crazy what she does. No,
you know,
crazy.
I had somebody had cyanide that was a level that we had not seen. So I called DEP and to make sure I was looking at it correctly. And she said, oh, they're not certified to do cyanide. I'm
oh,
like,
that's right.
Well,
that's
that
right.
Was
right.
With a, so apparently certain labs are not certified for certain contaminants. And this lab had done cyanide. They weren't certified to do cyanide. Now, I was, so I called the lab for the resident. And they offered to send the cyanide sample out at no additional charge to the resident and have a certified lab retest for the cyanide.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I spoke to it was Paula Karen about because all the you're right. You say state certified lab, but not all of them are certified for
yeah.
each contaminant.
Oh,
so
then that
ends up being another go around.
So then that segue. Let me just tell you this. So then that segue. There was a few properties, but owned by different people. There was new houses. So they retested all of them, okay, for cyanide, sent them all up, this lab did. I didn't call all those residents to tell them this was being done, the only one who knew about it was the one who I called and they were sitting in front of me. So then what happened, one of the residents came back and said, I said, I don't have your retest for radon or whatever it is. He goes, they were out there. I saw them out there. They pulled it. And so I'm like, I called the well company for them. I go, did you retest for radon for this resident? She goes, no, that was the cyanide. And I'm like, he probably doesn't know about the cyanide. And she goes, he didn't tell us to do the radon. See, they have to instruct to do it. I can't tell anybody to do anything. I'm not paying for it.
Right.
The person paying for it has to tell them
right.
what to test for
right.
and to pull the sample. It just is always something.
I think Jim will have some insight based on the message you left for me. I think Jim will have some insight, including some of the towns he works with, other towns that may have been able to streamline this process. Because we were trying to make it easier.
It either has to come in certified and checked off and passed, so we don't have to review it, sign off on it. Somebody else is reviewing it.
Right.
Or we have to get paid to review it and sign off and check off.
Right,
it.
Yeah, right. I mean, yeah, we have to have Jim or some other professional be able to get this whole package together and give it to Jim or give it to somebody that has the expertise to say this is okay and let them field the questions.
Right,
and
form that says this, all these requirements are met, signed off and stamped by a certified lab or engineer, PE, so on and so forth.
Right.
Turned in to us, we have our stamped copies, see ya, here's your permit.
And then when they have questions, then you know, you say, hey look, you know, that file has been forwarded to maybe it's Jim, maybe it's someone else, maybe it's someone he recommends. You know, they're handling that aspect. Yeah, that's a good idea, something like that. So, it's just too much. Judy, we love you, but you work too hard.
You need a vacation.
You do.
All right.
you wanted to have a public hearing next month, I'm assuming that's what.
That's not gonna happen, no, I didn't do my homework this last month, I was too busy, no. We'll get to it, I'm, at some point we will to upgrade, do fines over and stuff like that, and,
Title Five regs,
Yeah, fines and the supplemental Title Five stuff, and I think Jim is, I can get more input from Jim here, shortly on Title Five stuff. Let's see, Wells, Reflexology Spa.
That's something you need to go over with Cheryl as well.
Okay, alright. Let's see, next meeting, I guess we could talk about next meeting, anybody have anything else?
No.
Can we talk about that?
March 27th.
Yeah, that works. I apologize, appreciate everybody changing this around for me tonight, thank you. March 27th, that'll work, that good for you, Ken? Also, that's what we'll talk about, I can't remember what it is now, I guess. That's good, you got anything else, Judy, nothing more than that, okay, motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second, we're done. Alright.
You have a double dinner?
There you go.
The motion, Bill?
Yeah, motion, she's second.
Then go home and get some rest.
Yes, go home and get some rest, I know, well, it's fine. I am, yeah, well, I was supposed to start a 3-day.